My Richard's in the audience as well tonight. Where's my son with his lovely wife, Nina? There's my Richard. There's my Matthew. There's somebody going out. Aren't you enjoying it, sir? No. Oh, I can see who it is now. It's the Rumpole of Rotherham. This is Mr. Stephen D. Smith, one of the greatest raconteurs, and his beautiful opera singer wife. It's lovely to see you, Stephen. I didn't do it, you know, in court when you were attacking me. Oh, I nearly went down there then. Now, when Richard was born, of course, when he was a little scrap, and the doctor looked at his eyes, looked at his little ears, moved his little legs about. Then he wrote something on the piece of paper that goes at the bottom of the bed. And Christine said, go and see what he's written. I say, I saved it. I got this piece of paper and I was asked to keep it and I kept it to his 21st birthday. And on his 21st birthday, I said, Richard, you know Mum and Dad love you and we're very proud of you. And we want you to have this. And it was that piece of paper was framed for him in a golden frame. What is it, Dad? I said, it was the first thing, Richard, anyone wrote about you. The doctor. Really? Yeah. What's it for? When you are away, you might look on that. And when I am dead and gone, are you okay, Dad? I'm fine at the moment. But when I am dead and gone, you may look upon that little piece of paper and remember your parents who loved you. Is there a check with it, Dad? Well, this is... He's an accountant, aren't you, Richard, in Bermuda? Doesn't make you a bad person, you know. And his wife is too. But he's got it, and the piece of paper says, Richard L. Phinn. I won't say your middle name, because you've never liked Leonora. Richard L. Phinn. £7, 4 ounces. Weight of baby. Doctor's comment. Just two words. Poor sucker. I've also got in the audience tonight my other son, Matthew, who's a painter and artist. My Matthew. And next to him is Lizzie. My Lizzie, she's there, my daughter. And she studied psychology at university. My daughter used to speak to me, but now she observes me like a case study. But I'm very pleased to see you all here. And Dominic's friend's here, Matt. You've come from fire service, haven't you, Matt, tonight? Something very special's happened, isn't it, I hear? Didn't you have to dive in or something and save somebody? Yeah? Well, well done. It's lovely to see you. Well done. He's done it before, that young man. He's done it before, saved people's lives. Great, great fire service. You know, and so I was very lucky with my family and growing up. And, of course, when I go into schools, of course, I meet these children. And, of course, some like little Benedict have the best one can give them, and others perhaps not. But I find children, particularly the small child, the most fascinating of all. Because the little one, as I say, doesn't dissemble. And, you know, sometimes when I see them, you know that they're copying the ones they love the most, and those are likely to be the parents. The little girl in the home corner. The home corner is a little area of the infant classroom where children can act out the real world. It was called the home corner until it was changed with Ofsted to the Real Life Experience Centre. But there's a little girl. There's a little girl, and she's only 5. She's like an angel with a dolly clutched to her chest, and she's singing it a lullaby and stroking its head gently. And I go over to say hello. And this little one looks up at me and says, will you go away? I'm breastfeeding. And I said to her later on, tell me, Amy, do you watch your mummy breastfeed at home? Because you have a baby at home, don't you? Yes, I do. Why? Thought you did. Do you watch your mummy breastfeed? I help my mummy. Do you? Yeah. I help her put the baby on her nibbles. Do you? Well, I've got 4 children, and when they were babies, I used to do that. Well, I helped my mummy put the baby on her nibbles. Yes, so did I. You don't know my mummy. Then I was in Selby Infants. Outside the little Wendy house, Fred's Cafe, was a little boy of 5 or 6. Little apron with Fred on, like this. I walked straight past him, go in the Wendy house, sit down. I knew he'd come in. In he came, stood next to me. I said, good morning. I said, are you serving today? Might I have a drink? Got me the drink. I drank from a little plastic cup, had nothing in it, very dramatically, and said to this little boy, do you know, this is the nicest cup of tea that I have ever tasted. He said, it's a Budweiser. Then I was commissioned to lead a reading survey to test children's reading at the age of 6. Went round Yorkshire schools. I was using to test reading the Daniels and Dyack standardised analytical reading test, revised, version 3. And I get to North Allerton School, and I said to a little girl, excuse me, I looked at my random sample, could you tell me where Becky Johnson is? She said, she's in the Opticians. I said, you mean she's at the Opticians? No, she's in it. Well, no, if you're at a shop, you're at it. She's in it. No, she's in the Opticians. She is in it. There was a little Wendy house with Opticians above it. She's in it. Well, I go in and this little girl approaches me. She's only little. She's got a white shirt, a daddy's shirt on, and piece of string with empty frame. She perches them on the end of her nose and says, good morning, can I help you? Well, you know, I haven't the heart to say, yes, I have the Daniels and Dyack standardised analytical reading test version 2. I said, yes. I said, you may help me. I'd like a pair of spectacles, please.
Pardon?
Pair of glasses?
Pardon?
You are an optician, aren't you? Could you get me a pair of spectacles? She went off and fetched a friend, a little bit more confident. Friend came in holding her hand. Little friend came up and said to me, really in my face, we've got to test your eyes, you know. I said, yes, I thought you might. Can you read? Can I read? Can I read? I said, I have on my lap the Daniels and Dyack standardised analytical reading test, version 2 revised. They tested my eyes.
Little girl said, what sort of glasses have you in mind?
I'd like a pair that made me look considerably younger and very handsome.
We'll see what we can do.
I knew what she'd do. She fetched me a pair back like Dame Edna's diamante butterflies. I put them on the end of my nose, and of course they couldn't contain themselves and burst into fits of laughter. I was still in role. I said, excuse me? Excuse me? Are you the manageress of this shop? Do you generally laugh at your customers? I said, I come into your shop, you sit me down, you test my eyes, you fetch your assistant in who shouts at me. Then when I ask for a pair of glasses, you fetch me a pair. And when I put them on, I said, when I put them on, you laugh at me. You laugh at me. And a little hand came out and she patted me and said, it's only pretend, you know.